Can we talk about family though, and how you grew up around comedy and all that stuff? Because that, I think that's really cool.
But walling out and, you know, touring with Cat Williams. Walling out because I have a special coming out with them. I don't know when, but it's coming up.
So. Okay. And you opened for Cat Williams?
Yep.
All right, Ed will play some intro music and I'll lead the way.
No,
all right, let's do it!
Everyone, please silence your cell phones. Thank you. Oh, and for the Punch Up comics, at the end, like, I will put the light on and you'll hear. Where is it?
Who is that? It's
Mr. Spooky. He will play those weird sound effects too.
And we'll be starting momentarily, so everybody shh.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to another exciting episode of the Flapcast, Behind the Funny, where we find out what goes on behind the scenes of a comedy club. I am Barbara Holliday.
And I'm Joshua Snyder.
And we have an amazing headliner visiting us today, the fabulous Miss Shaunte Wayans. Give it up. Thanks for joining us, Shaunte.
Thanks for having me.
So, Wayans, I have to get right to that.
Yes.
You are a member of the Wayans family.
Yes, I am. I'm the unknown Wayans.
Oh, she's but very funny.
Yes, thank you. Thank you.
You're also funny.
Thank you.
It must run in the family,
it's
clearly.
Part of our genes, definitely.
So are you a cousin or a niece?
I'm a niece of Marlon and Sean and everybody. My mom is a sister.
Oh, yeah, okay. So. And does your mom do comedy too?
No, she's hilarious, but
yes, I'm sure.
She doesn't follow rules. Like, she'll curse anybody out. You'd be like, Mom, you're not supposed to do that. She's like, I don't care. She's like that type of mom.
So you got to be able to work clean. That's
yeah, she's hilarious. But she'll, you know, you'd be like, Mom. She actually got in an argument one time with Steven Spielberg. And she didn't know it was about, like, they were driving and type stuff. And I was like, Mom, that was Steven Spielberg. I don't give a hell. You'll never make it in Hollywood, Mom.
So I'm fascinated by the concept of now you're doing stand-up and you're amazing. And, in fact, you can come see her tonight in the main room and on November 13th in the Yoo-Hoo headlining.
Yep.
But how did you get into it? Like, were you watching your relatives and going, I want to do that? Or tell me the story.
It's funny, but if I could be quick, but Sarah, I hated being a part of this family. I hated because, you know, like, once they started getting famous, you know, where I was going to school and stuff, so people would, you know,
take
like, why are you coming to school in these clothes or blah, blah, blah. And, it's like people don't understand that they were just starting type stuff. Anyway, I say that to say for a long time I rebelled against wanting to be in the industry. Then I wound up going to college for computer science. I was a nerd.
You were? What school?
Yeah, Seton Hall University.
Oh, I know Seton Hall. I put comics there now.
See, here's the funny thing. I wanted to go to Rutgers, but I got accepted. I applied to 3 colleges. I got accepted to 2 and not Rutgers. So it kind of hurt me. I went to college for a semester and I said, hell with this. I moved out to California, and then that's when I started to get into it. I started out as an editor, production assistant, was doing stuff like that. And then I got into comedy probably like in 2003. I saw my cousin perform at a comedy club, and I went home and literally could not sleep because I had 2 jokes in my head. Went back, did an open mic, and they invited me to come do the later show. And from there, it's been amazing.
You're hooked.
Yeah.
Which club was it?
It was Ha Ha.
Okay.
I was trying not to, you know, promote the clubs. No, ha ha, that was
my
start.
Cafe, yeah, 3 lies in 1 name.
Yeah.
Ooh, oh, no, I'm kidding. I don't normally bash.
So you really started in L.A.
I started in L.A.
Do you remember your first joke?
Yeah, I still kind of do. My first 2 jokes, I had a joke about a woman president. And I said, you know, we shouldn't have a woman president because we'll probably be bombing for all the wrong reasons. I was just talking about how women are crazy and stuff like that. So I did this whole routine on just what a woman would do. Like, she'll try to, you know, she'll send out her army to go find her man cheating on somebody else. Whereas, you know what I'm saying? Like, she'll use all her powers for that. So it was that one, and then the fact that I date women, you know, I just had a lot of guy friends. Yeah, I know.
What?
I know, it's hard to tell. But, No, I talked about guys because I had a lot of guy friends who would, I would tell them a story about, I went on this date with this really awesome girl, and they go, really? So, you know, did you kiss her? And I'm like, yeah, you know, I didn't really want to kiss her. It was the first date. I walked into the door, and they're like, well, did you go inside? So they just kept wanting to know. I'm thinking they wanted to know about the amazing date, and they wanted to know if I was actually in there getting something. Those are my two jokes, and they evolved since then, but, yeah.
So, does your family help you with your material, or do you not like them to help you, or who's your mentor, really?
Oh, man. Yeah. They're all my mentor in different ways, you know, like, Sean actually sat down with me and taught me how to come up with my jokes, and then I started touring with Damon. I had, like, 3 minutes of material, and, you know, getting booed in front of 5,000 people. They're like, you're not a Wayans. I'm like, but I am. I just started yesterday. So we got to, you know, it was a gift and a curse growing up for a while, but they all kind of gave me, you know, Damon, little Damon, they all give me like punch ups. Even the family members that people don't know about, I call my brother, my cousin Craig, like we all just, I'm like, what do you think about this?
And so like you're hanging out, like it's Thanksgiving and stuff, and you're all like talking jokes or what?
Oh yeah, it's crazy. It's, I mean,
everyone's trying to top each other.
Yeah, it's if one thing starts off funny and it's funny enough, like you'll just hear a bunch of, it's like a writing room. It's a bunch of tags. Then you'll have like Sean and Damon, Keenan, like they'll all start acting out stuff. Kim, like, yeah, my grandma, my grandpa, they just start everything and it just triples. And then if you don't make a joke that's not funny, you're SOL. And everybody will know, even the babies, they're like, yeah. They just stop crying.
Now, it's part of the parameters. It's horrible. In-laws, or you know, people coming in, do they have to be funny as well? Is that kind of
I mean, it's one of the criterias. I mean, if you're not funny, you just learn not to talk as much. Don't chime in unless it's a serious topic. That's pretty much what it is.
Okay, I'm totally giving away age here, but I have to tell you, I used to work at Warner Brothers during In Living Color.
Oh, sweet.
And actually,
what does that make you, like 12?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I know. I look good.
Amazing.
But it was interesting because I always eavesdropped on the writing rooms, so I know what you're saying. And a lot of people think, like on TV, that, you know, just one person is writing. They get, you see the credits and you see one person because that's thanks to the unions. They organize who gets the top writing credit and who gets the other credit. But really, most shows involve 10 to 12 staff writers, and they're all contributing.
Yeah.
And you've seen that firsthand, I'm sure.
Well, I worked on My Wife and Kids. That's when I was in post-production mostly. I was like an assistant editor type stuff. We would go on stage and, you know, they would be rehearsing and anybody could chime in. Damon was really open to just letting people come punch it up because if it was funny, it made it.
Why not, right? I mean, that's the way to go. It's such a great, I think if you grow up with comedy, then you sort of understand that mentality.
Yeah.
Like, we're always changing, right? We're always taking feedback. We're always going, how do I get better? How do I get better?
Yeah.
But if you deny that, then you're probably not a good comic.
Yeah, honestly. You know, a lot of people get a little turn about their stuff, but I mean, like I said, the two jokes I started off with, I still do. I just made it a lot better.
Now, you've actually toured with Cat Williams.
Yes, I did.
How did you get that?
That was amazing. You know, Cat used to work on My Wife and Kids, and we had this like thing. I used to see him like walk on the stages, and I would just, we never said anything to each other, but it was like a stare, like something in the future is gonna pull us together. But anyway, like 3 years ago, I moved to Atlanta. About 2 months after I moved there, I performed at the Uptown, and Cat was there in town. He picked up myself and another comic to go on tour with him. And it was just like that.
Just like that.
Got on stage. Just a last show. We did a weekend. It was a Sunday night, and everybody was crazy because everybody was at the place trying to perform for him. And it was like, we're doing this show regardless, but people were just trying to get on stage. We did it, and yeah, he was like, hey, pretty much, I want you on my tour, so it was dope.
So I'm interested to see where your path is going to lead you because, you know, you've seen the celebrity stuff firsthand, and then you know, Cat Williams, I'm sure, you know, gets mobbed. Kevin Hart was just here. Yeah. That was insane.
Yeah.
How do you want that? Is that, or are you more interested in the craft, or what? What's your plan? What are your plans with comedy, you know?
I love getting on stage, and I love being a writer. I don't know about how famous I want to be. I'm not sitting here going, this is what I want to be this, I want to be at this level. Because I don't really care for, you know, we never had like bodyguards around like that and, you know, never lived that life. And I just want to be comfortable. I want to know my craft and love it and do that. I really want to write. I'm working on, you know, a sitcom for myself right
Ooh,
now. And stuff. Yeah.
Excellent.
But bringing my voice out would be the best pleasure that I could do as far as my career.
Right. Do you think it helps you being, I mean, everyone always wonders, you know, does it help you? I know, I actually want to do a comedy special with the comedy siblings, you know, because there's so many children of fame, like John Cleese's daughter performs here, Camilla Cleese, Will Schreiner's son.
Sweet.
Andrew Dice Clay, the Harvey. So, but I'm wondering, I feel like you get a little bit of kudos if you're in one of those funny families, right? Like, maybe 2 minutes on stage?
It's a gift and a curse, because I'm really not the person that's like, hey, I'm Shantae Wayans, you know, Wayans from In Living Color, White Chicks. I hate doing that, because if somebody goes, I don't care, then it's, you know, it's kind of like you just blew yourself up.
No.
Right. So, where's Damon? That's what they do to me. But it's a gift and a curse, because if I walk in with my uncles or my aunt, then I get a lot of love. But if I show up by myself, I get the, oh, you, nobody knows you kind of thing sometimes, so, yeah. So,
yeah, but you're awesome. I mean, as far as, you're a, not only a great comedian, but, you know, a great human, and when you're a pro. I think you've got it sort of emblazoned into your skin, probably, but, and then you do a great job on stage, too, so I think you're really making your own way.
Thank you.
I don't really associate
Or making your own
Wayans. It is a good name. Just to have fun.
No,
it
will give me a look. Like,
but
people do become interested.
Yeah, but
because
you
it's
gotta
like,
pull it out.
Then I have to pull
gotta,
it out, and that's the hard
up.
Thing because I have to work
twice.
On my, yeah,
yeah. Although twice as hard, really, honestly.
Yep. I gotta go. I was just doing a show in Toledo with Marlon, and it's funny because before I get on stage, I like to be in the audience. So like people, how rude they are sometimes. Like they'll push me or. You know, they won't let me pass. But then I get on stage and it's like, so then I go in a woman's bathroom after and they're like, you're so funny. And I'm like, great, wash your hands.
Now, how about the lady loving? Now, this is an interesting opinionated stance. See, I wanted to say,
I like the term lady loving.
Well, I was trying to jazz it up a bit, you know, give it a little flavor, but. Because nowadays, you know, it's awesome. I mean, but is that supported in your family? And is everybody cool? Are you just making your way, trying to stand out? Or is this, you know, tell me a little bit more about who you are.
I think, you know, my family has been really supportive. You know, my mom, when she first found out, she thought that she did something wrong. She's like, oh, I should have sent you to boarding school. I'm like, no, you shouldn't. I would have came back in a dress with Tim's on. But, you know, I think that people knew for the most part, you know, I played basketball and all that stuff. But anyway, my family.
Oh, is that the signal?
Kind of. Well, you know, let me rephrase it. I was on an all-boys basketball team.
Really?
An MVP for baseball. But we're not going to talk about the youth stuff I did.
Sports.
But they all were supportive once they found out. The guys in my family thought that meant more girls for them. That wasn't happening. But, you know, I mean, it's loving. And my grandfather's Jehovah's Witness, which makes it really weird.
Oh.
But he's very loving. He's open to me. I just, you know, I'm respectful when I go around them. But anyway, with all that saying, I think my voice and what I talk about, because, you know, I'm not sitting here talking about nasty stuff. I'm kind of talking about from both sides, straight people and gay people and how we feel. But I think I've gotten a lot of compliments just going, it might be harder for you, but when you push through, this is going to be like a gate opener. A lot of people's not talking about what I talk about, which I like.
And even in the African-American community, I would say also as well, not really prominent.
Right.
I think you're doing some really bold things, which is fun. And your attitude is just great on stage. I mean, you just do not deny people liking you. You have an instant likability. It's super cool. You'll have to come and see Shantae for yourself. Now, does everyone mess up on Shantae? That's a hard name. Are you named after someone?
I'm named after my aunt Devon. It's her middle name.
Oh, Devon.
Yeah,
sounds very much
like
very.
we're very, very close together. So, you know, she was like one of my closest.
Oh, that's cute. I'm named after my Aunt Barbara.
Yeah.
I'm Barbara after Barbara. Yes.
She middle name?
I'm named after Dave my aunt, Barbara. Too. That's
but, right.
After my aunt, yeah.
Aunt Joyce. You're the terrorist over here, Joshua Schneider. Sorry, if you cannot, obviously, our listeners cannot tell that Joshua Schneider is donning a sort of Middle Eastern terrorist look
lately. I think you say donning, right?
Right? Donning? Didn't I say?
You said doning.
Doning? So, doning? It's a little New York accent. Don, yeah, Jesus, the criticism.
Gosh, I know.
But like, look at that.
I know.
He said it makes him look more Jewish.
Hilarious. No, it definitely makes you look the opposite.
Oh, really?
Total opposite.
He's scary.
Arabian.
It's a little scary. Yeah. Did you know Josh was a virgin until about 2 months ago?
You know, it's like I'm doing the podcast with my mother. That's what this feels like.
Well, you asked.
Well, you definitely opened the door. I hope you talk about this on stage, because that's amazing.
Yes.
What made you finally just say he's like freak?
It was finding a woman who made every move and took every step of the way. I was.
Well, she had to show you. Oh, someone pursued you.
Yes.
And now you're just all over the place with it.
Actually, no.
Like,
no.
He took off his hat and everything. Was like, I don't care. What.
No, it's too stressful. Sex. I need another year. Before
it really is.
Yeah. See, now, Shantae, you're but really young. It. How did you always know that you were gay, or did you...
Barbara.
What?
Did I?
I know you said the sports, but that's...
No, that wasn't even it.
I know.
Let me tell you, my first... I had a... I remember being like maybe seven years old, and I used to play house with this girl. She lived across the hall from me. We would play house, and I just loved playing house. I would hang out with her all the time. And always wanted to be, you know, the dad or whatever.
Oh, you did.
I was so bad.
Oh,
but then I dated this girl in fourth grade who was a Jamaican. This was like my first.
You had a date in fourth grade?
Listen, well, she wasn't. It wasn't like be my girlfriend, but we used to hang out with each other. She was a Jamaican, the only girl with breasts in my school, and so all the guys were jealous.
Fourth grade,
but we didn't do nothing. I would just go like this. I would just grab her boobies, and I thought. That and hold on to her like this, and I thought we were really doing something.
We're married.
But every day after school was like the best thing. Every day after school we would go to either each other's house. For some reason, want to take a nap, and every nap time was just rubbing boobies and holding each other.
Wow. And you've not dated guys?
I have.
Oh,
I've tried. You know, I've tried to.
Right.
You try to do it, you know, but it was horrible.
I
would walk
around.
Yeah, I would walk around like this. I mean, I've been on like four proms, all types of stuff. I'm
trying to do all.
I've had great guys. I just never. My best guy relationship was dating this guy who I later found out was gay as well. And we would people would talk about him, and I would like want to fight for him. But we would skip school and go to his house and watch Ricky Lake. And he would never like try to have sex with me or anything. I was like, this is the best thing. Like,
no, I haven't seen this thing on stage yet.
I never talked about it.
I love it.
Then we came out to each other. We were like, I'm gay.
Oh,
me too.
Wow. Yeah. It all makes sense.
Yeah.
Oh, that's great.
have you done it with a guy?
I have.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
And at all enjoyable or just
good.
Like, yeah.
No, it's cool. I like to please, so I guess it was cool for me because it was like, oh, yay, he did something, but I just never did too much for me. Mm. Never.
Do you want me to explain Joshua the actor? You have it down now.
Just send me the Wikipedia article.
Oh, okay. Yes.
It was just a great. I was the only girl. Like my friends were having sex, and I was like I used to love to. I don't even know if I can say this. Like get.
Oh.
Can I say that?
Yeah, what? Sure.
Get head.
Oh, get it?
Yeah, I used to love to.
Get it or give it?
Get it. Like,
get it.
Yeah.
Get it.
Definitely not this. More like that. Yeah.
Right.
But I just loved having guys go down on me.
We are going a little bit deep
this too much.
Today.
Sorry,
no,
listeners.
It's good. Yeah, we might get some new listeners.
But that's
actually
what I'm talking about. See? I'm opening up the
some
crowd.
Good stuff. I didn't know you could even talk like this on a microphone. This
See,
is
this,
good.
Is there a technique? I should know this, by the way.
Oh!
Well, listen, you're talking about waiting a year. You're going to be, like, completely a newbie again.
We need to
let you... You're supposed to have a little fun before you know.
I'm genetically incapable of that.
No, we're going to help you out a little bit.
He is.
We're going to help you out a little bit. You're handsome.
No, thank
you're
you.
Very handsome.
Yeah, well, ladies know how to please each other. Yeah. See? Yeah. So
but I'm wondering, like, I've heard that you're supposed, like, I heard the Sam Kinison bit about how you're supposed to lick the alphabet. Is that, I don't know, is that?
I mean, it works. It's just really, you, listen, there's so many things you can do. Just focus on right there. And I'll tell you another little trick. I don't even think we could be talking. I'm not a sexual person, so.
She's even embarrassed right now.
No, like, because I don't want to be, like, nasty, but I think, you know, like, while you're stimulating there, like, insert, you know, one of these or two. And
you're very clinical about it all.
Well, I've helped a guy, like, actually keep a girl before, but you just want to stay, stop going all over the place.
Okay.
And if you feel, if she's making noise and you could tell she's kind of enjoying it, stay the hell there.
Yeah, I tried it. Sheer silence.
Yeah, well, you know,
you gotta work on this.
Yeah, well, right. Trust me. We'll
talk about it.
Yeah.
Next plastic. Girl you have, bring her over. Yeah, my girl plastic. And I will teach you some things. Yeah,
plastic doesn't respond well. You know, right?
They do have those toys though.
Yes, wow. Well, this is really good. You could probably write a book on this. I imagine.
Do the what guys should do.
Right.
Gosh, I want you to write
Clint
it all
tips.
Down. And I'm gonna give it.
Give it to.
Give it.
I
don't
know.
Men.
I think you should call it Clint tips.
Clint tips.
We're gonna write the book together. We'll do an answer or question.
So you know, there's so much more to
a tongue-in-cheek guy.
Sex card, right? Well, stay tuned for that book coming up. Shantae, what is your Twitter? Do you have a Twitter?
I have a Twitter.
Or should I say a twatter?
Or titter?
I'm so sorry.
No, I like twatter.
Yeah, twatter.
I'm going to change that. Hey, twatters. I like that. Thanks. You guys both give me.
All right. We're punching it up.
What
is your Twitter?
Instagram, Twitter, or Facebook. You can find me at CWANS.
Oh, good. That's easy.
W-A-Y-A-N-S. Because people still spell it wrong.
Right. So. W-A-Y-A-N-S.
Yeah.
Wayans. C-Wayans. You don't have to spell Shantae.
No.
At C-Wayans.
Yep.
Perfect. And your website? Do you have a website?
It's cwayans.com.
Oh, okay.
A little on the construction.
Oh, that's okay.
Wix is waiting for me to give them a new car to pay. They want me to pay.
What? You have to pay for a website?
$4.95 a month.
$4. Hey, we'll take care of you here at Flatfurs. We'll hook you up with that. I think there's free websites now. Who
we
is
should
on
do
this?
WordPress.
No, huh?
We should do WordPress now.
Yeah,
Wix
but you
is...
still have to pay for hosting.
Oh, all right.
Well, so, it's the WordPress and Wix, but if you don't pay a certain amount, you have to keep their name. So it's like cwayans.com/WordPress.com. You're like, I don't want.
Right.
See me about this website.
I will. Yeah. Write that down.
So, Shantae was here. Like I said, she's coming tonight. If you're here for Celebrity Drop In Tuesdays, and all kinds of great people drop in actually and do that. We've had Bill Burr stop in. Damon Wayans has stopped in. Kenan has stopped in. David Alan Greer. Whitney Cummings. Oh my gosh, must the list go on? So. Tuesdays are a happening night, actually. You never know because people are in before they leave town for the weekend to do gigs. So come and check that show out tonight. And also, again, Shantae Wayans is in the Yuga Room headlining on November 13th.
And a little bit more about tonight,
hosting?
Too, by the way.
Well, but...
It was my night.
It's Shantae's show.
So you're right.
Right?
It is your show.
Okay. It counts. Right. You know, Brad Garrett was here, and he just does the most amazing thing. He hosts because he has such a great attitude about it. You know, everyone's dying to see him, and then when you watch those other comics go up, then everyone's going, "When's Brad? When's Brad?" So by going first, you know, like Shantae Wayans is here. Let's see if you go first, then it sets up all the other comics so well because you're like, "These are my friends. These are my choices." And then all the other comics do better versus going, "When's Shantae coming? When's Shantae coming?"
Right. No, and I like hosting. It's fun. It helps me.
Oh, it's a great skill.
Yeah, so
and
I
plus,
like
you'll work forever if you're a good one.
Yeah.
That's for sure. I know that. We always need. Always. Especially females. Yeah.
Flappers. I just want to give a quick shout out to Flappers Comedy Club. I'm serious. You guys, let me tell you, not only do you guys give comedians a chance, but you guys, like, it's just this warm feeling coming here, and I really, really appreciate you guys.
Oh, thank you so much. Get your hands off my breast.
Yeah.
Okay. Just kidding. All right. So we have been punching it up with you. We do this segment here on our Flapcast every week called Punch It Up. Yes. Would you help us out with
Let's
that
do
today?
It. Let's do
we
it.
We have a few comics who would like to come up and do some time. They're going to do like 3 minutes, and then they're going to hear this amazing sound effect, hopefully, which is delayed. A delayed applausation from our sound booth. Anyway, and then they're going to come over and talk to us, and we're going to see if we can't give them some ideas and punch up their stuff. Are you guys ready?
Let's
do this. Punch it up. Joshua.
All right. Let's start off with Alex Weitzman, ladies and gentlemen.
Alex Weitzman?
Yes.
Wow. That's not Jewish or anything, is it? Hi, Alex.
Swedish.
Swedish.
No. Totally, incredibly, very Jewish. Good evening, everyone. I had a utterly horrible realization about myself recently. I've been playing this video game called Mass Effect, which you think would be about the repercussions of altar boys in Catholic clergy, but no, that's not what it's about. It's this sprawling sci-fi epic with, you know, big horrible monsters carrying guns in backwoods areas. You know, not unlike Duck Dynasty, really. But here's the thing about this particular game. It has a karma meter. You know, it will, every little thing that you do, every little thing that you say, it will tell, you know, it'll score you as to whether it's the good, honest, upright thing to do, or you're kind of a little bad, a little naughty on the wrong side of the law. Here's the realization. I am the world's biggest goody good. Ugh! What is wrong with me? This is a video game. It has no consequences. Why is my superego getting involved at all? There's this little voice in the back of my head saying, oh, that's not nice to say. Fuck you! Back off! You're making me into a hall monitor! God, it's like, and it's a science fiction war game. I played this to be Han Solo. I'm freaking C-3PO. Oh dear. Please don't hurt me. The only thing I can do is shudder and bow. The other piece of really good news in my life is that my dog was in surgery recently and had a huge mass on the side of her snout come out. An ugly mass that's not cancer. Yay! But here's what I learned about my dog in the process of doing this surgery. She doesn't respond to anesthetic the way any other dog or human or being on the planet apparently does. Because, you know, she was out for the surgery. It wasn't one of those, you know, horrible fever nightmares where they're performing an autopsy on you and you're awake. Ah! But no, instead, she, after the drugs wore off, she was immediately awake again. You'd think she would be out for a while, but no. She instantly up and was like, and she was pissed. She was like, who did this? Who took a knife to my face? Was it you? I am gonna yap into your ears so much they'll hemorrhage! I probably failed to mention she's 14 years old. This is the, you know, she is Sheldon Adelson old. You know, I don't know. I asked the vet, they're like, are there uppers in the air around here? Is cocaine a necessary part of the surgical process? And so it was one of those things where I was imagining that they were just, everything was bad in the middle of the surgery, and then suddenly, nurse, we're losing her. I need 4 grams stat and a playing card, at least a face. Mix, cut and cut and mix. We need to do it at least 12 times. Don't snort it! It's for the patient. Thank you very much.
All right, hey, Alex Weitzman. Grab that mic and come on over here.
Get over here.
Alex.
Who is this Alex?
Look at you.
This is somebody, this Alex is somebody that Josh brought here.
Oh, Joshua, of course.
Joshua is the blame for this.
Hence the sci-fi connection, right? So, Alex, how long have you been doing stand-up?
Maybe a little bit over a year.
Oh, a newbie.
Comparably a newbie, yeah. I've been mostly focusing on like acting and particularly voice acting and such.
Oh, I can see that. You're a character actor for sure.
So yeah. So you two both broke your virginity at the same time.
No comment.
So
you notice I did that nice and low as if to imply things.
No comment. Do you want to address some thoughts or?
I was just gonna say the first joke. You talking about the game? I like the whole like the your ego comes out more. Mm-hmm. I was saying maybe to explain that in the beginning before you like really get into the game, because that might be able to lead into other topics of what do you get so egotistical about. You know what I mean? That could be really small. Mm. So if you're in a game, that's not really your lifestyle, but then it becomes that because...
Totally. You know what I mean? Yeah. Absolutely. Thank you.
I know you were going for that mass effect, like mm-hmm. the Catholic sort of pun, I think. Right. But maybe if you set up a little bit more prior to that, that you're Catholic...
Which I'm not.
If
at some point somebody, I mean, obviously we're performing to a large crowd of people who are incredibly silent.
I'm talking about that connector though.
Right,
it's a really far stretch. I know what you were going for with that word, but like I had to really stress to try to get it.
Yeah.
Versus you wanna, if you're gonna do something punny like that, I think you just need to spoon feed it to the people. And then I have a big note on, you are so cute and silly and, you know, I see the character, if you're, you know, obviously our listeners can't see you, but I mean, I can see you in a Seinfeld episode or, you know, I mean, mm-hmm. there's a one thing that was disheartening for me though is when you actually got angry, mm-hmm. I think I would be careful to maybe yell that strongly, mm-hmm. Unless you're doing it maybe in different voices. Like even the animal, for example, voice was the same as the other angry voice.
Right, okay.
So if you could give them some flavor, maybe jazz them up, make different sounds. Yeah, because the angry was like, oh my God, he's so cute and adorable and look. And then he's like yelling. It was very tough.
Story of my life. Nobody wants my anger.
Well, use it for something, you know. You got to understand two things, especially being noob. I perform places where it's been my closing joke. And I've murdered it a lot of places. You can go to a completely different place. And because I didn't do it to make them understand, like she was saying with the joke of massive, I didn't understand what it was. Mm-hmm. But I'm just saying it doesn't matter if it's two people in here or it's a sold out show. They might still not get it if you don't, you know. The
really
audience
lead
is
them
dumb.
To it.
Yeah, they could be a little dumb. You have to, you got to treat them, they're babies. Real talk, they're babies. You got to go into explaining.
Yeah, and there's a real difference between like real anger and emotional truth anger, mm-hmm. if I can say that. So like, you were really angry, like in a movie role, I would say great, you know. But like here, it wasn't playful enough for me to get into it, if that makes sense. And if you do it in the character voice, if you do it in the character, then you can get away with it, and because you can give it a little more, you know. Dimension, I guess. And that was my big note, because it distracted me from listening to you. Like, I was kind of scared, you know, versus just enjoying and listening to what you were saying. So, and as always...
Thank you. That's a good note. Definitely.
Yes, and goody good. I didn't quite get what you meant by that, but I think I know where you're going. But again, I think we need a little confession here. Mm-hmm. Like, are you... You are a sci-fi geek. Do you never do anything wrong? Or why? What does goody good mean? What does that mean? Is that what everyone calls you because you never do?
It never comes up. I was just in reference. I mean, God forbid I explain the joke at this point because that will go ahead and kill it. But I mean, ultimately, it was just a reference to the fact that it was, you know, this karma meter, and inevitably I learned, like, you figure, oh well, you start doing all like. You know, all sorts of bad things because there's no consequences to the video game. You know, it's not like you're going to have to deal with being a jerk. And I can't apparently bring myself to be a jerk even in a fictional setting.
See, you got to take it as no, like, especially
step forward.
Well, look, if guys play, I never even heard of the game. So if you would have said, if you would have said Call of Duty, probably most guys and me would have got that. But for women, you got to take, again.
We're dumb.
Think of it as half of people over here plays video games and these people don't. You always think of the
that
crowd.
That was hard. Right? But yeah, maybe that's all. It's just a little more setup.
Totally.
Crafty there.
Yeah.
Right?
Let us know you're a geek. Let us know that you know something about Catholic or whatever.
And the karma meter is fun. Don't run over that. Because right. I did hear it, but it didn't hold.
Karma meter.
That's right. Interesting. Right, right. But we have to hear what it is. And what's our sci-fi expert over here have to say about...
It's interesting. I know Alex more than anyone else. We went to college together.
What?
Yeah, and we were theater majors.
Virginity is catching?
Right. I don't. I hope it's not contagious. I would hate to make that. I just want to apologize.
The world's worst Ebola.
Right. I would apologize to anyone I've touched or not touched.
The one good thing is it's spread by bodily fluid. So
right. That's the weird thing. No, I sometimes fear that my awkwardness is contagious. And that it is.
Yeah.
No, the very first day that I met Josh, Josh was a year ahead of me. He was a sophomore when I was an incoming freshman. And the very first things they make you take in at Chapman University as far as a theater major goes is a class called Voice and Movement. You haven't actually graduated the scripts yet. They're just going to have you do sounds.
Button, beautiful banana.
Some variation thereof.
Button, beautiful banana.
Exactly. You don't even start out with that.
You start out by, you start out by trying to cry. That's how I did it.
Oh, gosh. This sounds horrible.
But basically, the very first day, Josh was serving as a teacher's assistant. The whole bunch of teacher's assistants.
You do look like that's not tits and ass.
And I raised my hand in the middle of the opening spiel by one of our professors and asked some asinine Captain Obvious question, and our professor Michael Nearing immediately screams out, "Talking brain! It's a talking brain over here, Josh! Help him!"
Remember that, Josh?
The note that we always got was we think too much when our heads, and that we overthink things, and that really not much has changed.
Why don't you two get together and have like a sci-fi writing group or something? That's what I would recommend. Could you hook that up?
We can. I just feel like we might help each other best.
Now, who followed who in a stand-up?
Josh has been doing stand-up for significantly longer.
Right. And you're just getting the bug.
Barely. Josh has been encouraging me for a while, and I thought I was just too chicken shit to get into it. Honestly.
Well, it's a long road. A year is nothing. Yeah. I mean, I don't mean to.
Oh no,
down,
not at all.
But there's a long couple of years.
I mean,
yeah, and a lot.
I know 60-year-olds that just started that money.
Yeah. But Alex, thank you so much for joining us and being playful, and I hope that our Punch It Up was helpful for
Absolutely.
You.
Absolutely.
All right, and we'll see you here at the open mics and stuff, right?
When I can get out here. I actually live about an hour away, but...
He's a Claremont one.
Listen, this is freaking comedy. This is grinding, so if you're trying to do this, I don't care
where
you live.
Get up
No, I get out to the Claremont one all the time.
Yeah.
Oh, awesome.
We're in Bourbon.
I know.
Thanks for joining us, Alex. Thank you so much for being at Sound Effect. And we still have time for one more, right?
That's correct. We do. All right.
Who
guys.
Else do we have?
That guys, keep it going for Paul.
Paul!
I don't know his last
name. Walter Hauser. Eisenhauser. Paul Hauser.
It's German. We're close enough. My name is Paul Walter Hauser. I have 3 minutes of prepared conlingus jokes. Yeah. So you guys talk about it. I had so much good conlingus humor. No, I don't. Well, we're on the topic of women. We're on the topic of ladies. I may as well say I do like my women like I like my coffee. A little bit of cream, a little bit of sugar, huh? Warm, but cool enough to drink. There are refills, and it's not women, it's coffee, it's just coffee. There are no freaking women. There are, but I'm a big guy. It's really tough to find women when you're a big dude. I used to be 333 pounds at my highest. I'm currently down to about 270. This is the part where a room full of people would clap in adoration because I did something good and productive. And so many, I will not take it off. So many comedians don't do good things in their lives. So when they say something good, everybody's like, oh shit, he had a kid. Good. Hopefully he doesn't screw that up. But I did audition for The Biggest Loser. It's an NBC reality competition weight loss program in which some chubbers lose the blubber. And I went in Downers Grove, Illinois to check that out and try it out. What I didn't know and what I wasn't prepared for is they put you in a room with these NBC producers and there's 10 seats. And I didn't know that I had sat in seat number 10. So I had 9 stories that preceded my story. And these weren't just like, I love Oreos, saturated fats. These were really horrific stories. Like the first woman who said, it was my last chance at having a child. My husband was on the brink of leaving me. He didn't want children. And I was so depressed when he left that I kept eating and got onset diabetes mid-pregnancy and lost my daughter. So this show, because of my depression, could literally save my life. Then it went to the second person, some guy who goes, I was going to commit suicide in high school, and everyone kept calling me fatty, and then I botched the suicide. So I kept eating, thinking maybe the food would kill me. So if I joined this program, this show could literally save my life. 7 more people gave their stories, then it got to me, and they said to me, they go, you sir, why do you need to be on The Biggest Loser? And I go, I don't want to wear seatbelt extenders anymore on board American Airlines. They go, what? I go, Old Navy. I want to be able to fit into their sizes of clothing again. And they're like, buddy, you are offending us. These people poured their hearts out to you. You're talking Old Navy and seatbelt extenders? And I go, sex! I would like to have sex eventually. It's on my to-do list. Bucket list of things to do or have done too. That is, and they go, buddy, I don't think it's your weight that's stopping you from sex. I think it's the Old Navy aspirations might have something to do with it. Thank you very much. That's my time.
Alright,
say hello to us.
Hey,
gang.
Paul Walterhouse. Whoa. Wow, what energy, Paul.
I've got energy, guys.
And I have to say I know Paul because Paul works in our ticket booth up here.
Oh.
And he's an aspiring comedian as well.
I have the pleasure of being a doorman and host here, which I live very close. This was like the perfect job. I love comedy. I love outgoing people, and this is like less than a mile from my place, so I'm spoiled to be
this,
here.
This is not a date.
You're like, bro, you can chill out with the whole life. You don't have to kiss her ass, dude.
Watch out, you might get laid with statements like that.
By the way, I got a quick win story. I was doing stand-up here a couple weeks ago, one of the only times I've gone up here, and Sean drops in for 15 minutes right before I go on.
Oh.
And I was just like, oh, shit, of course Sean Wayne drops in right before me. And he slayed. He was just having fun, very off the cuff, probably developmental stuff. But the second he got off, he warmed up the crowd so much it didn't work against me. It actually worked for me because everyone was in a better mood.
Yeah.
And I've seen it work the other way. So that was really cool.
No, it does help sometimes. Especially picking it up and stuff. They're just still giggling. So
now, Paul, you do some improv too, right?
I have a little bit of improv training from Chicago and then a little bit out here. Just kind of doing a lot of stuff. I'm primarily an actor. I've been doing stand-up off and on I started when I was 16. I just turned 28. That sounds like I've been doing it 12 years hardcore, but it's been very, like, lax. I would say 4 or 5 of those years were real years, and the other ones I went up, like, you know, twice at a cafe or something.
You holding that microphone like you're giving a blowjob.
I'll tell you what.
I'm so uncomfortable with this by my mouth right now.
I have a tremor. It's a thing in your hand where it like kind of shakes. It's like Parkinson's, but not hardcore.
What
so,
the heck? Why isn't that coming out on stage?
It's a little scary. I'm like, not Josh Blue where I can really use it and make something amazing out of it. This is just like
that a little inside slam there?
No, not a slam.
Shante, you don't know who's to rep Josh Blue.
Oh.
He has cerebral palsy. He won the last comic. Disabled performers.
Yeah. Well, he's amazing.
And that's why he won.
I look like I'm giving a ghost a hand job sometimes, though, so it's not really cool.
Hey,
I gotta keep that in check.
Yeah, but you need to write that
the tremor.
Down,
so.
You know what's dope about the tremor, too, is especially if you can't really feel it. I know people, like I was taking a picture with this girl, and her whole body was just shaking me, but you can't see it. So there could be something in there.
I mean,
what does it affect if nobody can see it? You know what I mean?
I don't know. It's off and on, too. It's weird. But then again, talking about it is therapeutic, yeah. Probably.
I'm saying there might be some funny...
Oh,
is
it literally Parkinson's?
Yeah. I'm already thinking
of jokes.
It's not
that hardcore, no.
But it is Parkinson's.
See, it's half-ass
sure.
Parkinson's. It's
yeah.
it's
can
like,
I get a governmental
like
benefit
ass.
Somehow
hey,
from Lyme disease? Government, I have tremors. Can I pay
hey,
my rent?
You should.
I need a parking spot.
Right.
Because you don't want me trying to park with this, you know, wavy hand going on.
I
want to
throw this out there. Josh got a lot of crap for his beard, but let me tell you, it looks kind of cool. It looks like an edgier, less Woody Allen Josh.
Hey.
You look like the guy who might beat the crap out of Woody Allen, like he'd walk up to you and try waxing poetic and you just elbow him.
Paul,
in the face.
You're just saying that because you look like Zach Galifianakis.
I got the beard right now. I'm up for a roll right now. I can't shave until I find out yes or no. So
oh, well, good luck.
Better
with that.
Figure
what's
that
the,
out.
What's the role? Can you tell?
I'm up for a show that Paul Giamatti's producing over at WGN. It's this weirdo, like...
Is it called Everyone Looks Like Paul Giamatti?
It's called Paul Giamatti's Fat Sons. It's like a weirdo, like, if Stephen King did Sons of Anarchy, it's called Titans. And it's very dark and weird, and I don't know what the deal is. I've been on hold for, like, 5 weeks. They keep saying, yeah, we're waiting to find out. But then I'm on another show right now called...
Shooting a movie right now and stuff.
Yeah, well, just keep waiting.
I don't know whether to take them serious or not. I'm on another show right now called Kingdom, which I am going to pimp out for 2 seconds.
Uh-huh.
It's on DirecTV. It's called Kingdom. It's about MMA fighting, and I play a really troubled character in the first 7 episodes who's like in a rehab clinic for like emotional mental problems.
I can see that. good work.
Typecasting, right?
Well, are you serious about stand-up then, or is it just a little extra?
I think acting is the like, hey, I can make money job. I think stand-up is the, I enjoy doing it. I love stand-up comedians, and I would like that to become something secondary in time, you know?
I like the first joke, the coffee. I have an idea, though, a little bit to make it tighter.
Yeah.
It's a great joke and a great reveal. But I think you should describe the coffee a little bit more realistically. I like my coffee warm, delicious, black, with sugar. Or, you know, like...
Extend it.
Yeah, like, be very clear in those words you're choosing. Because you kind of muffle them to get to the reveal, but that's a really funny setup. Just, you know, moist, warm, cozy, delicious, yes, creamy, you know, all the words...
I was almost thinking if there's a way to get to you just being by yourself. Like, I like it. Like, I like my woman, like, not around kind of thing.
Right,
you know what I'm saying? Like,
masturbation.
Yeah, it's like something like, I don't know. I was saying moist and all that stuff. I'm thinking, like, in the rain without, you know, hearing somebody talk. But something to where it just leads to...
And I'm in my room crying with my family photos.
Right,
giving
right.
a punch. Yeah.
But it is a good joke. There's just, I'd say, craft it a little more. Like, really craft those words and pick those choices. Because it could be really, really funny. To set us up to absolutely think you're talking about a woman. And then, no, it is just LaBaza.
Right.
Or name a Folgers. Maybe even name the brand.
No, my shit's not even Mick Cafe or something like that. Oh, can I say the S word? Sorry.
Yes, you already did.
Sure as shit.
By the way, no one can see. I'm like beet red right now because I'm in front of a Wayans, my boss, and a guy who's had sex. I'm very intimidated right now.
I thought you were just doing this the whole time on stage because I did look at him and was going to say something.
A little blotchy. I look like I got rosacea.
I'm just enjoying, this is the first and last time I'm the guy who had sex.
Every time I see you, I will definitely, you know. I almost thought you got laid when he was complimenting you.
Bro,
like,
I'm a,
hey, you might not even have to worry about learning clits.
I'm fat and I'm a Christian. You know how difficult sex is for me, both emotionally, physically, spiritually. I am effed.
Oh, where is that stuff on stage?
Your Biggest Loser thing too. It's you said you used to be bigger, right?
Yeah, I lost about 60 pounds.
Dude, there's something funny in the fact, because like for me, I want to get rid of my stomach, but I could tell like I'm puffy. But I could just imagine like going from, let's say, 300 to like 240, and you look completely different, but you're still fat. You know, oh, sorry.
Is this not good
guys, it's getting real.
I mean,
right.
Biggest Loser, I had to lose 60 pounds right. just to audition for right. you.
No, no, it's you true. Know? It's funny that you're better, but you're still not better. It's, right. it's
but,
crazy.
But the different the reaction that people give you because you used to be, you know, this big, and now you're like still big, but you're, you know, people are starting to come to you a certain way. But is that, it's why did you choose to be to do The Biggest Loser? What was that point that made you start going, I gotta fucking lose weight? Excuse me, I have to lose weight. And yeah. then, yeah, what was that? What happened during your weight loss? And then, you know what I mean? Because you can start being cocky now. You can start, your whole attitude can change, but you're still not at your goal yet.
That whole process. Right. Yeah, I never think, you know, and that's sort of the no barber gig, which is like extended. I never really, if I hit on something, I'm like, oh, that's the target. But I'm not looking at the periphery of it.
Go deeper. I was just about to say, like, the tremors. If you don't talk about the tremors, I'm going to kick your ass.
She's not talking about the Kevin Bacon movie, by the way. She's talking
you
about
can't be doing that shit and not be talking that's about funny. It. And remember, it's yours. Own it.
Yeah.
It does. It's not. Not a shtick or a hack or anything. It's what, it's your perspective. Like, even it's a semi-disability. It's not even a real one.
Right, I can't really complain about it. It's not real. It's not really real.
But it's.
But you can use it sucks. To certain advantages. Right. You can. There's so many things. And again, like you, I mean, I thought you were really funny.
Your character.
Yeah, you. You could definitely just start going. What made me want to do this? Why was I scared? Was I not? You know, start bringing all your emotions into what. You're saying because you're semi disability. You're I mean, it's funny. It's
yeah,
funny.
Those like, halfway problems. Yeah, that's great. Well, thank you for the advice. You guys killed that. I really
and
I'm
never ever say cunnilingus. It just never say that.
No. Okay. No, totally. And no, for the listeners as well, Miss Wayans here is not puffy at all.
Oh.
She's just a woman and inherently has body dysmorphia.
I can see the trembling now. I think the trembling is. Don't do that, sir. Don't do that. No. Thank
you guys are awesome.
Paul, you keep at it. I see some potential here for
I think
sure.
I want to
She's
build
like,
puffy.
You could be a server someday.
I'm seeing a POS repair guy. What about that?
We're moving you out the ticket booth.
Paul, he's leaving without even us telling him goodbye.
Goodbye, Paul. Walk
nice exit. There. Nice exit. Wow, that was a fun, interesting day, huh?
Yeah.
Shantae, nice work. Nice
had a
work.
Lot of fun. You we have to do this again.
Yeah.
I had fun.
We get to talk about you and all your material and when you're going to be performing again.
Yeah, tonight.
Can you remind them again?
Tonight, 8 o'clock.
I just want to say something really fast. This is purely obsessive compulsive on my part.
Oh, God,
but
what?
Last week in the podcast, I made some jokes where I made fun of Aurora, and I just want to apologize.
Colorado?
Yeah. Not that anyone's complaining, but I'm just worried that 10 years from now.
Do you guys even have listeners from Colorado?
I don't think we do. I'm just I'm trying to cover the
base. Well, I'm just saying.
We only have 8,000 downloads.
Well, I'm just
saying. I bet they're none of them are from Colorado.
I don't think they would be. I'm just
actually, we have a lot of foreign listeners.
That's
what I'm saying. China.
Like China likes us.
There's 12 people in China.
They just
they're
trying to
make fun of them.
Decode what y'all saying.
There might be
these funny Americans. They talk like my impression.
She didn't do that because she's black.
Hey, they're listening to us
too.
They're listening to us on the iPad that they built.
Oh, is that right? Let's see how it works.
I heard
they
a comment
so
just say that.
Yeah,
do you think kids from China?
You guys
China
are racist. I'm done with this podcast.
All right, don't forget Celebrity Drop-In Tuesdays tonight at 8 o'clock, and Shantae Wayans on November 13th in the Yoo-Hoo Room.
Did you hear that? That's Wayans, inflatable to Wayans.
cwayans.com and cwayans on
Twitter,
Twatter.
Instagram, Twatter. I'm
it's
taking
your own
it.
Special version of Twitter.
I'll give you credit.
And then who's in Burbank this weekend?
In Burbank, we have the delightful Craig Shoemaker, the Love Master. And then at 10 p.m., Shantae Wayans again, I believe, right?
Oh, are you
no.
Oh, she can't.
On the 24th. No, I'll be out of town. But November
13th,
oh,
for Shantae
and friends. Wayans.
Whatever. And then in Claremont.
In Claremont, we have the delightful Dan Gabriel.
Delightful, yes. Silly
yes.
and playful Dan Gabriel.
At 10 p.m., Joseph Burbank. Also, we have Jimmy Dore, who's preparing
working
a new special.
On a new special.
He'll be dropping in.
Don't miss that. That
Jimmy
guy
Dore
has
Wayans.
Opinions, I'm saying.
Jimmy Dore Wayans, Kel Mitchell Wayans.
Thanks for listening to another exciting episode of the Flapcast.
Thank you.
I'm sorry, we made no, it's
cool. My chicken is very cold.
Yes, we'll get another.
Very good.
Thank you. You can listen to it.
Oh, yeah, because I'll
follow it. Yeah, please. And if you follow us, do you follow my Twitter or our Twitter?